So hello, everybody, and welcome to our next talk in the DiveRSE series. I'm Jeremy Cohen from Imperial College London. I'm along with a team of organisers have been organising these DiveRSE talks over the last couple of months. I'm going to do a very brief introduction, and then I'm going to hand over to Paula, who will be chairing the session, and she will introduce our speaker for today. So from me, just to say there's a brief schedule that we'll be working to. So just a few minutes of introduction. I've just got a few words to say at the start, then Paula's going to give you a quick introduction to the RSE Australia New Zealand group, and talk about, I think, some upcoming events. And then we will have our main talk, followed by some time for questions and discussion. Just to highlight, some of you will have just seen the pop-up that's come up, that we will be recording the meeting. We'll be putting the talk online afterwards for people in regions who it's not terribly convenient timing, so that they can watch it afterwards. So please do ensure that you remain muted during the talk, and we will be recording just then the slides and the active speaker. So just a quick bit of background to this series. So for those of you who perhaps haven't seen previous talks, or haven't seen any of the publicity we've been putting out within the research software community about these talks, this series DiveRSE is linked to a workshop that took place back in April in the Netherlands. And the workshop was focused on looking at diversity, equity and inclusion aspects within research software. And what we're hoping to do with this series is to bring the talks from that workshop, and also a number of the kind of discussion areas that were brought up at the workshop, to a wider community. So hopefully this is something that you'll find it's certainly, I think, some interesting topics within the series, and some interesting things that we'll be doing both during today's talk and in the coming talks. And you can also look at the website to see the videos from the previous two talks. The video from our keynote is up, and the other talk that we had in May will be up shortly. I'd also like to just highlight to you the code of conduct. The code of conduct is on the DiveRSE website. Those of you who have attended other workshops and meetings, I'm sure that applies to most of you, will probably be familiar with such codes of conduct. But I do encourage you nonetheless to take a look and to familiarize yourself with it. And just to say that obviously does apply to all communications and discussions related to this talk and the discussion today, but also to the rest of the series. So as I say, we do appreciate you familiarizing yourself with that. I'd like to just say in advance thank you to our organizing team, who've helped set up and publicize this talk, and to the various contacts internationally who've been helping to publicize the event. Obviously, thank you to our speaker, Kelly, and to the RSE Australia New Zealand group for helping to support and to co-organise this event. So with that, I won't go straight to my closing comments, because that's for later. I will unshare my slides, and I'm going to hand over to Paula, who will be saying a little bit about the RSE Australia New Zealand group and chairing the talk. So Paula, over to you.
Thank you, Jeremy. Welcome, everyone. My name is Paula Martinez. I am working for the Australian Research Data Commons. I am also one of the steering committee members of the Australian and New Zealand RSE Association. I'd like to begin today by acknowledging the Jagera people, who are the traditional owners of the land in which I live in Brisbane, Australia. And I pay my respects to the elders past and present, and I extend the respect to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people that are joining us today or watching the video. Now I want to share with you the website of the RSE UNZ, if I can find that. So for everyone who is not part of the association yet, I'd like to invite you to join us. We are an advocacy group for Australia and New Zealand. We are a community that represents different people. So if you see yourself as a researcher or an academic who are coding for research, those who bring communities together, maybe software engineers who work in the research domain, or system administrators who are maintaining research systems. We welcome you all you just need to click on the link to join. Tell us about yourselves and what your relationship to research software engineering is, and just be part of the mailing list. We are active via the mailing list, where you can ask questions and share events or job postings, or even start new groups for discussion and working together. The two things that I want to share with you is that we have plans for conferences in September. And the first one is the New Zealand Research Software Engineering Conference, which is going to be fully virtual between the 12th and the 13th of September. In the same week, the Australia and Asia RSE associations are joining together to also have a virtual conference between the 14th and the 16th of September. So we would like you to come to us and join us. I will put the links in the chat for you to look after, and stay tuned for the registrations, which will open in July. That's all I want to say, and now I welcome our speaker of today, Kelly.
Hi, everyone. Thank you to the organizers for inviting me, and to all of you for attending. I just want to give a little notice that I am on research and study leave, so I'm traveling at the moment. I'm not in an ideal office environment. I do have children in the house. It is very likely that you'll hear screaming in the background at some point during this talk, so apologies in advance. So today I want to share with you a study on software code review. That is one particular software practice, and I'm hoping to use that as an example to discuss why we potentially need to reimagine software engineering practices and software engineering tools. Now, to start off, I'd like to just give a caveat of who I am. So I'm a software engineering researcher. I don't research software engineering specifically, I look at software engineering more broadly. Oops, get to the next slide. Okay, so my view as a researcher is I see software engineering as a socio-technical activity. So teams of developers have to come together when you're working on large software systems, and they have to collaborate to create that software product. So it's not just the sitting behind a screen and coding, but it is people working together. And so I look at the human aspects of software engineering mostly in my research. So I look at the social activities that happen in software teams. And research in this area has moved from looking at when software engineers should collaborate to looking more at how they collaborate. So looking at things like sentiment, emotion, and those types of things in how the collaborations are happening on software teams. And one particular area that I have gotten more interested in recently is kind of the culture in software engineering. And so a social perspective that I wanted to discuss today is, you know, we've seen research that shows that there's negative sentiment and emotion in software engineering and communications that are happening, right? And this isn't necessarily a bad thing. Developers, you know, disagreeing isn't always reminiscent of a toxic environment, but there's other research that shows that there is discrimination, that there's profanities, there's insults, there's toxicity. And we see evidence of this also happening in the industry. So not just in open source software, where a lot of the research happens because it's so easy to access the communications of the open source software teams. But we also see evidence that this is happening in industry as well, that there's this toxic environment that exists. One of the studies that I'd like to highlight is pushback during code reviews. This is a study that came out of Google, and they were looking at pushback as defined as negative interpersonal interactions that happen in code review. And so these are things like harsh language or insults, that kind of thing. So it's pushback is not just saying, no, I don't like the code and I think it could be changed a little bit, but it's actually this harsh and toxic type conversations that happen in code review. And so they found in their study at Google, this was relatively rare. It did happen. But the problem that they found is that when it did happen, that it had really negative repercussions. So people were much less motivated and not wanting to work as much. So they weren't engaged as much after this type of activity was happening in their teams. So there's evidence from research and anecdotally that this toxic culture exists. we've seen, just as Jeremy alluded to today, a push towards codes of conduct. So we've seen open source software projects adopting codes of conduct. It tries to, these codes of conduct try to set the ground rules, right? You say what type of behavior is acceptable or unacceptable. It can be a signal that your project is in fact wanting to be inclusive. It's telling people that they're welcome. And the codes of conduct have been adopted by a lot of projects, as well as conferences and corporations and, you know, even this organization today. But in open source software, there's also a movement against codes of conduct. This image here is showing a GitHub repository that was created. It's called the No Code of Conduct Movement. And the basic premise behind this is that people in open source believe, you know, everybody here is adults and we're capable of having adult conversations and we don't need to be told how to treat other people. Everybody just inherently knows how to treat other people of varying and different backgrounds, which of course we know is not always true, right? Different cultures behave differently. And sometimes having ground rules of expectations can really help just create more inclusive environments. So despite the move towards having more codes of conduct, especially in open source, this study that recently was presented just this year at ICSE, so the International Conference on Software Engineering, found that toxicity is still existing in open source. So this study looked at toxic comments, which they found using various heuristics, and they identified the different nature of the comments. So they found lots of insults, arrogant behavior and unprofessional behavior. Interestingly, what they found is they looked at who was making these comments, and it wasn't just people that were looking to troll the project. It was experienced developers. It was core members of the team having this insulting and unprofessional behavior towards others. It was also people that were creating issues. So entitled behavior was happening when people wanted new features or fixes in an open source software project. They were acting very entitled, and that can be difficult for the maintainers as well, having to deal with that kind of behavior. And the target of this toxicity was not just at the code, it was at the people involved in the project as well. So all of this leads me to kind of my motivation on why I wanted to do this study that I'm going to share with you today. And I looked at software code review as a particular practice. So software code review is common in the software industry. It's been shown to have many benefits. So knowledge transfer, improved code quality, just to name a few. But it can also bring a toxic environment. And this tweet is just representative of some, not everybody, of course, but some views in the industry that software code review can be honest or it can be nice, but you have to pick one and it can't be both of these things at the same time. And I'm hoping that my results, which I have been sharing with industry as well, can start to provide some evidence that it actually has to be both at the same time in order to improve code, in order to create inclusive environments. So the study that I did, we studied perceptions of feedback in code review, and we were using a destructive criticism lens. We're looking at negative feedback that is both non-specific and inconsiderate. And that's the definition of destructive criticism. And this lens comes from organizational psychology. It's been shown to have negative impacts in lots of other domains. And there has been shown to be gender differences as well in some of the domains. But we didn't really know what developers' perceptions of software code review were. There's that common belief that developers should be able to take harsh feedback if they're like a real developer, right? And I don't like that kind of stigma in software development. So I wanted to kind of prove that that's not true, that not everybody has this belief. And so we did this through online questionnaire. So we used vignette style questions. We did not subject developers to destructive criticism in real code review. Rather, we presented them with these hypothetical scenarios. We kind of described, imagine that you've just worked on this code. We gave them an example code snippet. And then imagine that you receive this feedback as the first feedback. And the vignettes were randomized. So some of the participants saw a destructive version of a comment and other participants saw constructive versions of the comment. So you see here, what the heck is this? We don't need a null check here. is a destructive version of the feedback that they would be hypothetically pretending to receive. And then you don't need to protect against instance of against null pointers is the constructive version of that comment. And so participants saw two different vignettes. One was constructive and one was destructive for each participant, but it was randomized on which one they saw the destructive and constructive feedback. And then we asked them various questions like about the vignettes themselves. So how they perceived those vignettes, how motivated they would be after receiving that feedback, that kind of thing. And then we also asked them about the frequency of the destructive criticism that they received in their own software development roles and their general opinions on destructive criticism. We also asked some demographic questions so that we could look if there was demographic differences in perceptions of destructive criticism. And so we had 93 participants. We used convenient sampling, so we put up lots of advertisements and we conveniently got 93 participants. We had 43 men, 43 women, 3 who were non-binary and 4 who chose not to disclose their gender. The average, we had about 7.8 years of development experience. We had open source software developers, developers from industry, and also students. So it was almost roughly split between those three groups of people. And here, this slide is showing our results on the perceptions of destructive criticism around three questions. So we asked for those, for that feedback that they received in the vignette questions, we asked them if they thought that feedback would help them to improve their code, if it was valid feedback, and if the feedback was appropriate. So you can see here at the top, the constructive responses. So when, you know, each participant had one scenario that was constructive and one that was destructive. So for the constructive version, you see that the green shows agreement. So participants are overwhelmingly agreeing that the feedback would help them improve their code. It was valid and it was also appropriate. But at the bottom, you see the gold coming out more strongly here. So participants are much less likely to agree. So they're strongly disagreeing that the feedback is appropriate when it's destructive. They also don't think that the feedback will help them to improve code. So even though they think it's valid, so you see the middle line there, that the feedback is in fact valid. So it's pointing out something that is wrong with the code, but it's not going to help me improve the code because of the way that it is inappropriately written. So that's what this is showing, right? So it matters how you actually write your feedback. You need to be nice to other people, not just honest. And then we also asked about motivation to continue working. And we saw again at the top, the constructive criticism, people were overwhelmingly agreeing that they would be motivated to continue working on the task with the developer and on the project if they received constructive criticism. But at the bottom, they were disagreeing. So they were unmotivated to continue working when they received destructive criticism. And most strongly, they were most strongly unmotivated to continue working with the developer. Now, we also asked participants if they would respond to the feedback. So, you know, you get feedback from somebody in your software code review and you can write back. So we asked them, you know, if you would respond, write it your response here. And we had for the constructive criticism, people responding with their agreement, you know, yep, thanks for the feedback. That's right. I'll fix it. Acknowledging that they received the comment and that it would be fixed. Whereas in the destructive criticism, we saw people asking for more information and disagreeing with the manner of discourse in the criticism. So specifically calling out that it was inappropriate for them to give feedback in the manner that they were giving it. This disagreeing with the manner of discourse in the criticism was much more common for experienced developers. So inexperienced developers did not respond in that way. For both constructive and destructive criticism, the participants wrote comments disagreeing with the criticism on a technical level. So this wasn't related to constructive or destructive. There was just some people that disagreed with the feedback that we chose to give in the vignettes. And then the tone of the feedback. So again, if you're responding to the feedback, the constructive criticism, the respondents were writing gratitude and praise. So thank you for finding that issue in my code. And, you know, great job finding my issue. So the people were overwhelmingly positive and happy when they were writing a response to constructive criticism. On the other side, they were neutral, so it would just be a matter of fact kind of comment, or they were apologetic. And the apologetic comments came overwhelmingly from less experienced developers. So less experienced developers were apologizing for mistakes that they made in the code when they were being given really inconsiderate feedback. And then there were some sarcastic comments that developers wrote, and a few also that had anger expressed towards the person that wrote the destructive criticism. And you probably wouldn't be surprised to see that we saw differences as well in constructive and destructive criticism in terms of the mood that the participant reported that they would feel after receiving the criticism. So you see here, after receiving constructive criticism, overwhelmingly, participants felt positive emotions, great, at ease, good, and composed. Whereas after receiving destructive criticism, they felt much more negative emotions, so bad, tense, nervous, and uncomfortable. And we've seen research in software engineering in the past that shows that negative emotions can really impact developers' productivity and performance. So it's important to note that this destructive criticism can cause this negative emotions in developers. Right, and then I said we also looked at demographic differences. So here we saw that women perceived destructive criticism as less appropriate. So on the Likert scale questions that I was showing you earlier, they were statistically significantly more likely to say that the destructive criticism was not appropriate. And this is compared to men. We did not have enough respondents from non-binary participants to conclude anything statistically significant, so I'm only showing statistically significant results here. Women were also less motivated. So they reported to be less motivated to continue working with the developer and on the project after receiving destructive criticism. And again, this was a statistically significant difference. And I highlight this particularly, I have this women are less than 25% because we know that women are marginalized in software engineering, right? There's not enough women. And if women are feeling less motivated to continue working after receiving this type of feedback, and this type of feedback is happening, which we've seen evidence in past research that it is, this could potentially be a problem for retention of women in software engineering. And so I think this is important to start doing something. And I also alluded earlier that less experienced developers were less likely to call it out. So I think this is also important. So when you are new to a team, you're less likely to call out this kind of behavior, you're more likely to apologize for it. It's not setting you up to feel like you're an included member in your team and want to stay long-term in the software engineering industry. So I think these two differences are really important and should be considered around retention of people in software engineering. All right, another interesting finding here. We asked people how often they both gave and received destructive criticism. And we broke this out in non-specific and inconsiderate, because that's the definition of destructive criticism. So we see here that people report to receive much more destructive criticism than they report to give, particularly for inconsiderate feedback. So only one of our respondents reported to give inconsiderate feedback, so 1% of our respondents, whereas 22% reported to receive inconsiderate feedback. And of course, there's different reasons for this. It could be that, you know, there's a small minority of people that are giving this kind of feedback, and so more people are receiving it from this small minority. Or it could also be that people don't, they're not aware of when they're giving inconsiderate feedback. And this is particularly important because people in the responses were noting that they feel like they maybe are giving inconsiderate feedback unknowingly, because people can react to feedback differently than you would expect, right? So, you know, you might be trying to do your best, you might want to give great feedback, but you're actually, it's being received as inconsiderate. So we're not sure why we see the discrepancy here, but those are two possible options. And then we also saw some really differing opinions when we asked about general comments on destructive criticism. So we had this question here, and the first two bars that you see where it's predominantly agree We asked participants if they thought destructive criticism was harmful and if we thought it would cause a negative reaction for the recipient. And participants overwhelmingly said, yes, destructive criticism is bad, right? When you ask it in this kind of generic way, it's harmful and it's going to cause a negative reaction. They agree. But then when you ask them a slightly more nuanced question, so when receiving code review comments, I don't mind getting inconsiderate feedback as long as the feedback helps to improve the code quality. Here we start to see a difference in participants. So we see people, 60% of people have disagreed with this statement, but 31% of people agree with this. So they're saying that they don't mind getting inconsiderate feedback for the sake of the code quality, right? So abuse me as much as you want. Don't care about my well-being or my general happiness if the code will improve. So it's this belief that, you know, it's fine to have this harsh criticism because code quality matters more than my own personal well-being. And we also saw these differences come out in the open-ended comments. So we also asked some open-ended comments in our survey, and these are just two kind of indicative comments that we saw. So we saw some people saying, you know, actually this is a hack, is not negative at all, right? So I'd rather just have easier to parse and act upon feedback, even if it appears harsh and inconsiderate. Like, I don't mind if it's harsh and inconsiderate. I just want feedback that will help me improve my code and do it easily. I don't want to have to think too much about the feedback. I just want easy to parse feedback. Whereas the other kind of side of these comments were saying things like, feedback always needs to be communicated in a considerate way. It's important for me to learn, so I want to be able to learn, and I need to do that in a considerate way. So I'm not going to kind of absorb the feedback if it's written in a harsh or inconsiderate way. So there really were kind of these differences of opinions across our participants. And, you know, this is not the first study that has examined gender differences or differences more broadly across demographics. We've seen other research has found that debugging strategies are different across genders. So this study from 2009 found that women actually debug very differently than men, and that debugging tools were not as well suited to the strategies that women were employing because they were, you know, built for the primarily male environment of software engineering. There was a similar study that found code reading comprehension strategies differences across genders, so that women, you know, read code and comprehended code much differently compared to men. And so, you know, this points to possibly that our tools, the very tools that we're using in software engineering, are not geared to work for all people that we want to be involved in software engineering. They're geared for the people that are already there, but maybe not the people that we want to be joining. Another study by Mendez et al. More recently in 2018, they looked at GitHub through a kind of cognitive factors lens, and they found that GitHub has inbuilt gender biases. And this is by looking at different cognitive factors. So basically, you know, research from psychology has shown that there are gender differences in different cognitive factors. One of them is learning style for new technology. Not all women, but more women than men prefer to learn through process-oriented learning. So like how-to guides and tutorials, that kind of thing. And they want all of the information available so they can figure out things sooner. So this of course does not apply to all women, it doesn't apply to me, but it is something that applies to more women than men. Whereas men are more likely to kind of tinker and just want to jump into it, and they don't need all the information upfront. And so when they looked at GitHub through this cognitive lens of these different gender differences in cognitive factors, they found that GitHub was much more accommodating towards the cognitive styles that are more likely to be associated with men. So GitHub can be harder to use for people on the other end of the cognitive spectrum. We've also seen pull request acceptance rates, differences across genders, across race and nationality. We haven't seen very much research in software practices and tools outside of the gender differences. A recent systematic literature review by Rodriguez Perez found that almost 70% of are studies that are looking at inclusion and diversity in software engineering are focusing only on gender. So these are the kind of differences that we're seeing, only gender, but we need a lot more research that looks at other kind of demographic differences, and we can find solutions that will make these software tools and practices more inclusive to a wider group of people. So that leads me to kind of my question that I wanted to pose for discussion today is, how can we reimagine software engineering tools and practices to center diversity, equity, and inclusion, and not just gender diversity, but, you know, broadly inclusion for everybody that wants to be a software engineer or a research software engineer? How can we make this environment through processes, practices, and tools more inclusive? And I'd like to conclude with just a little story, some kind of food for thought. This story is about the five monkeys. I don't know if anyone has ever heard this five monkey analogy before, but basically it's a research study. No one knows if it actually ever happened or not, but there was a study of five monkeys. And the five monkeys were in a room with a ladder, and there were bananas on top of the ladder. And anytime a monkey tried to climb up to the top of the ladder, one of the researchers would spray all the monkeys with cold water. So eventually the monkeys learned that they didn't want to climb up to the top of the ladder, right? So they'd start beating up any of the other monkeys that tried to get to the top of the ladder because they didn't want to get sprayed with water. And so eventually the researchers replaced one of the monkeys. So this new monkey comes in, there's four monkeys that have been sprayed with water before, but this fifth monkey has never been sprayed by water, and they see bananas at the top of the ladder and they climb up the ladder. And the monkeys instantly pull the monkey down and start beating up the monkey. So the monkey never gets sprayed by water, but learns eventually to stop climbing up the ladder because it doesn't want to get beaten up by the other monkeys. Over time, the researchers continue to replace the monkeys. So eventually there's five new monkeys in the room. None of them have ever been sprayed by water, but they continue to beat up the other monkeys that are trying to get the bananas. So the point of the story is, you know, it's time to reflect, right? Like, what are we doing? We don't know why we're not going for these bananas. Maybe it's perfectly acceptable to go for the bananas. Maybe we need to change what we're doing. We shouldn't be basing what we're doing now on some historical precedents that, you know, you might get sprayed by water. There's no evidence that you're ever going to get sprayed by water again. So let's rethink and reshape software engineering to be more inclusive for everybody. And so just to very briefly conclude, my study showed that destructive criticism in code review does have a negative impact. It has a negative impact compared to constructive criticism for everyone, but there was a greater impact on women. So women saw destructive criticism as less appropriate, and they were less motivated to continue working after receiving it. There are conflicting opinions on destructive criticism in software. Some people think it's very fine to give destructive criticism, and I think since we see that people will perceive destructive criticism negatively, we need to try to change this and figure out how we can make it, you know, the new tweet that code review needs to be both honest and kind. And, you know, there's also evidence of gender differences in other software practices and tools. We need a lot more research to see how we can make these tools more inclusive, and not just to gender. We need to look beyond gender and intersectionality as well. And so we need a lot more research in this. And I'm hoping that, you know, some of the people in this room are going to be inspired to do some of that research.
Great questions there. Yeah, just from my side, just to say, obviously, a big thank you to Kelly and Kelly for the fantastic talk, and to Paula for chairing and for giving us an introduction to RSE Australia and New Zealand. And do, if you're based in that region and you're not a member, do sign up. And there's lots of stuff. I know that the community has been doing some really interesting things. So certainly a great community to engage with. And thank you also to Paula for helping with setting up the registration and hosting. So that's been really helpful. Our organizing team, so we have a kind of international organizing team behind the events who have been helping to kind of promote across the world. We've got, I think, a really, really good reach now into lots of different regions. Obviously, the timings of the talks are not always convenient for everybody, but it's great that we've been able to advertise this widely, and I hope we'll have a lot of people engaging with the video after the session. And obviously thank you to members of our audience for joining. So we really appreciate you taking the time to come and listen to the talk, and hope you found it an interesting and enlightening experience where you will hopefully have some interesting ideas to go and look at afterwards. Certainly I found it really interesting. It's really great to see the work that Kelly's been doing. So with that, I think we will close, and I'll just highlight that our next event, which is going to go up on the website very soon, will be on the 5th of July. So if you keep an eye on the website, I'll put the link in fact, thank you, Paula. Paula's just put the link in the chat there. So 5th of July for the next talk, and that's going to be focusing particularly on open source and looking at some issues around diversity and inclusion within the open source community. So that should be really interesting, and I think a really interesting follow-up to the talk from today and some of the discussions from today. So thank you all very much, and I hope to see you at future events.